Sometimes it's clear that we're carrying on, safe as baby Moses in the rushes, floating toward what God has planned. That's the we can rest.
confession and forgiveness. God of all time, forgive us our false busyness, the busyness we manufacture to make us seem important, the busyness we invent to keep us from ourselves, the busyness in which we hide because we fear to stand still, to be alone, or even to be shaken. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved in the name of Jesus Christ. Your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with the power of the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in our hearts through faith. Amen. God rich in mercy, by the humiliation of your Son, you lifted up this fallen world and rescued us from the hopelessness of death. Lead us into your light, that all our deeds may reflect your love through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our first reading today comes from Numbers chapter 21. From the Mount Hor, the Israelites set out by way to the Red Sea to go around the land of Eden. But the people became impatient on the way. The people spoke against God and against Moses. "Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no food, no water, and we detest this miserable food the Lord had sent." The people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned by speaking against the Lord and against you. Pray to the Lord." And the Lord said to Moses, "Make a poisonous serpent and set it on a pole, and everyone who is bitten shall look at it and live." So Moses made a serpent of bronze and put it on a pole, and whenever a serpent bit someone, the person looked at the serpent of bronze and lived. This is the gospel, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And then from the letter to the Ephesians, chapter 2. "You were dead through the trespasses and sins in which you once lived, following the course of this world, following the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work among those who are disobedient. All of us once lived among them in the passions of our flesh, following the desires of flesh and senses, and we were by nature children of wrath like everyone else. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of a great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come, he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not of your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared before to be our way of life." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So, I'd like to invite the children to draw close. We are going to be talking about a very familiar song. In fact, if we were all here together, we would probably sing it from memory. The song is, "He's Got the Whole World in His Hands." And that's an incredible song because you can make up verses as you go. And, you want to give it a whirl?
Sure, it's got the whole world.
Gifts of women from all over the world. And one of the things that I discovered when I was taking a is it's considered a traditional spiritual, and it was written originally by an African-American woman named Nina Simone. Now, we don't hear a lot about Miss Nina because there was, I don't know exactly how it happened, there was a gentleman who picked up the song, and more often than not, his name gets credited with he's got the whole world in his hands. But the truth is, Miss Nina wrote that. And so we are celebrating the gifts of women artists, and music writers, and lyricists, and preachers. We're celebrating the gift of the women of the church. And so it is really important when we sing he's got the whole world in his hands, that we have a whole story about the whole world. So let's pray together. Faithful God, we give you thanks for the gift of women and men in this church. This day, we give you thanks especially for Miss Nina Simone and the way that she wrote a song that is now written on our hearts. Help us remember, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that all of us, every single one of us, we are in your hands. And that is an incredibly beautiful gift. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Because we are getting vaccines in arms and Jerusalem with the shadow of the cross falling across our path. Might we carve, who is this beautiful human who is both science and liturgist? If you don't know him, it's worth a look. Mike Hart invites us into today's story and into the Lenten story and into the passion of Jesus. And we know that there is a cross-shaped climax. We know what is coming. These are Mike's words. The cross was not God's invention. It was ours. In all of our need for an eye, I have to wonder sometimes if God listened to us cry for blood and offered his own. If Jesus' sacrifice on the cross was not to sate God's wrath, but to show God's response to ours. Let us pray. Faithful God, as we continue to journey with your Son, Jesus Christ, to Jerusalem and to the cross, we pray that you would be with us to give us courage. When the way is shadowy, O God, draw near to us and encourage us to move ever onward. May we be aware of your grace that both heals and sustains. Now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O God, our strength. For the sake of full disclosure, I'm struggling a little bit with some reflux issues that affect my vocal cords. And so if you hear a rasp or if you hear a cough, no need to worry, not COVID. In fact, second shot going in this arm on Friday. So we find ourselves in the Gospel of John yet again. Tim Johnson, theologian, notes, it is particularly ironic that in today's gospel, Jesus specifically and without a doubt rejects the very literalism that so often dominated the reading of this text. We can find that out by backing up a little bit. Nicodemus, a Jewish teacher and leader, comes under the cover of night to ask some questions of this very unusual rabbi. Together they speak of an unusual array of topics, including being born again, that really threw Nick for a loop, and the blowing of the wind, and the way Moses lifted up a serpent in the wilderness. When Jesus offers the metaphor of birth to speak about spiritual growth, Nicodemus, like so many people, takes an incredibly literal approach to Jesus' words and says, how can one be born a second time from the mother's womb? John tells us, almost as a side commentary, that Jesus was amazed at Nicodemus' literal understanding of this evocative image and says to Nicodemus, you're a teacher of faith, and yet you're unable to understand what I'm saying. Jesus would be equally amazed at how his invitation to deepen our encounter with God through a rebirth of the Spirit is still used today as a literal basis for exclusion, rejection, dominance, and judgment. If the life and example of Jesus gives us reason at all to be literal in our reading of Jesus' words, here it comes. It would not be John 3:16, but rather John 3:17. For those of you who may be new, every single time, I in particular speak of John 3:16, I always add, into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. Neither Jesus nor John in his gospel were interested in establishing a belief system to be the cornerstone for acceptance or rejection by God. They were, however, very interested in the question of how one comes to faith. How does one grow? How does one mature in one's experience of God? If our interest is in deepening our walk with God, rather than creating belief systems of exclusion, then this passage from John, including John 3, 16, and 17, has a whole lot to teach us. Here are some of the promises we can stand on. As I mentioned earlier, the most faithful proclamation of John 3, 16 always includes verse 17 and the realization that God didn't send Jesus in the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. This passage of scripture also is a promise because it is not to be understood as a litmus test for what is right or wrong, who is in and out, but instead, it is supposed to be a sweeping expression of God's love. We read, he loved the world so much that he gave his only son. I will acknowledge that sometimes it's hard to make sense of it all. And Nicodemus, he did not get it the first time around. And yet Jesus never gave up. So what happens if we still don't get it? What if we have more questions than we have answers? What if peace feels elusive? What if nights are long and restless? What if the weight of Lent is bearing down? What if we still don't get it? As I mentioned, Nicodemus didn't get it until he got it. And both parts of that statement are crucial to hear. Nicodemus, he was a teacher of the law, he was a religious authority, he was curious and open-minded enough to seek out this young rabbi, Jesus, and even after he did that, he just didn't get it. He's confused about what it means to be born anew again from above, and it seems a little sad, as we wrap up this particular lesson, that he eventually kind of fades from the scene. Guest to return to his official role in his life. If it was up to us to judge, Nicodemus at this point in the story, the truth is our verdict probably would be very positive. He meets Jesus, he talks with Jesus, he gets to hear the gospel in a nutshell, and yet he can't seem to shake his old ideas or old practices, so seemingly does not come to faith. This outcome lies in sharp contrast to what we will encounter in the next chapter of John chapter 4, where a character as polar opposite as we can imagine from Nicodemus, the Samaritan woman at the well, she has an encounter with Jesus, she hears what he has to say, and it changes her whole life, and immediately she brings others to Jesus. So, on the one hand, we might want to say, poor Nicodemus. For you see, he's not a shining example of the power of the gospel. But if we keep reading, because that's what we're called to do, Nicodemus, in fact, does appear again. And not under the cover of night. The next time we see Nicodemus, it is in the light of day, as he comes to claim Jesus' dead body, and along with Joseph of Arimathea, to give Jesus a proper burial. This is important because it reminds us that there is no single timeline of how people respond to God's good news. Additionally, it cautions us continue to be at work in the life of those God has called. Our job, our response to the gospel is this. We are called to testify, to bear witness to the light, and to place the responsibility for salvation upon the broad and able shoulders of the Holy Spirit. So, if you get it, good for you. We celebrate with you. And if you still don't get it, we stand with you, praying for you, and hoping for you, and believing for you until you can pray and hope and believe for yourself. And the thing that makes that possible, this is going to sound like I'm beating a dead horse, but the thing that makes that possible is John 3:16 and 17, which is always understood as a promise rather than a condemnation, always understood as hope rather than despair. Richard Rohr writes, every time God forgives us, God is saying that God's own rules do not matter as much as the relationship God wants to create with us. So on this overcast Sunday morning, at the beginning of spring break, when we've lost an hour of sleep, we rest on this. God always, always has been, always is now, and always will be about a relationship of love that transcends and transforms. Because God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save it. Amen.
The Lord has promised.
His Spirit is among us. We profess our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Relying on the promises of God, we pray boldly for the church, the world, and all in need. You sent your Son that the world might be saved through him. Inspire the witness of the church throughout the world. Empower missionaries, Bible translators, and ministries of service in your name. Bless our partners in ministry, our ALCA Global Partner Churches, and young adults in Global Mission. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. From east to west, your steadfast love is shown. Nourish seas and deserts, wilderness areas and cities. Give water to thirsty lands. Nurture spring growth that feeds hungry creatures. Bless farmers as they prepare for the growing season. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. You sustain your people in the wilderness. Give courage to all who lead in times of crisis and scarce resources. Prosper the work of those who aid victims of famine and drought. Bring peace in places where scarce resources cause violence. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Your mercy endures forever. Deliver all who cry to you, especially those who are hungry or without homes. Give life in places where death seems triumphant. Give healing to those who are sick and comfort to those who mourn. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. By grace we have been saved. Fill this congregation to overflowing with that grace that we show mercy to others. Nourish any in our midst who are hungry, especially children, and bless our ministers of feeding and shelter. Give us patience and courage when the way seems long. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Your Son is lifted up that whoever believes might have eternal life. We praise you for all who have died in Christ. Bring us with all the saints into the fullness of your promises. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. We entrust ourselves and all our prayers to you, O faithful God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Also with you.
I invite you to share this peace with those who are around you. So for me, that's John, Nancy, Jim, and Christopher and Adolphe. If you could share peace with one another along the way, either by sending a text or an email or having someone near you, that would be great. I am going to invite those who are present to be seated, and we will continue with some announcements, first beginning with Pastor John.
Shift our mic over here so that this next part of the service gets, heard. So I wanted to share about Joe. Hang on. I wanted to to share about Julian of Norwich, which a lot of folks might not know. It was a woman of the 14th and early 15th centuries, and it looks to me like she was named after the church in which she had a little cubicle in which she lived. She was what was known as an anchoress, so she lived in seclusion, kind of like anchorites, the version of monks that on the male side that do the similar thing, but they're devoting their life to kind of an austere, ascetic kind of life, so they can focus on prayer. And the time when she, and the reason I'm bringing her up is that we've been singing one of her lyrics for the last several years. And folks might not know, because it's Women's History Month, I thought it'd be good to learn about it. But in that period, as you might recall, there was Black Death, Peasants Revolt, a lot of really hard things going on right where she was in Norwich in England. And then there was a stretch when she was about 30 that she had a personal illness that was so severe she thought she was going to die. And in the midst of that, she had these visions, what she called showings, that had been passed down through the church until she was actually one of the first folks that my seminary history professor had me read. And there's a beautiful moment where she's envisioning the whole world as like just the size of a walnut in God's hand. And there are these moments where she's envisioning Christ's face as he's on the cross and just feeling the depth of his love. And so one of the things that she says in the midst of all that, all shall be well, and all shall be well, and all manner of things shall be well, because it's all held in God's hand and it's all moving through Christ to God. Like wherever we are now, it's a starting place for where we're going. And so we've been singing that, you know, in the gospel verse. We already sang it as part of this service, but I just wanted to share that. And now I will turn it over to you.
We continue to make decisions related to worship based on safety and the guidelines by the Knox County Health Department. Today at 3 o'clock, our COVID response team will be meeting, and my hope is that we continue to broaden our opportunities for worship. There are three that we can make use of. We can have as many as 10 people in the sanctuary as worshipers. Nancy and Joe are examples of that today. We are grateful that they are here. And then at 11 o'clock, we meet outside on the parking, the back parking lot on the corner of Gay Street and Emory Place. Socially masked and distanced, a little bit abbreviated, and yet at the same time, a word and sacrament service. So we hope that you will join us for that. And then at 6:30 during the Lenten season, we gather for a Zoom format that is then streamed to YouTube and Facebook Live. Some folks really appreciate the Zoom format because they can see the face and it feels a bit more intimate. So we're working day and night, night and day, to meet as many worship needs as possible, and we are grateful that you have joined us today. The other thing that I would highlight, we're in the midst of spring break, but coming up is Holy Week. On Sunday, March 28th, we will begin with Passion and Palm Sunday, and that will take us to Monday, Thursday, Good Friday, and Easter. And there's many, many reasons to be hopeful, so I hope that you will be a part of all of that. Chris and John, I'm going to make a bit of a change on the fly. Rather than a sub-communion liturgy, I think I'm just going to go with a spoken communion liturgy. So we will do that. And John, if you would be so kind as to help us sing the Lord's Prayer and the Lamb of God, that would be great. Let's consider the gifts that we bring to God with the offering followed by the offertory response.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Faithful God, you walked beside us in desert places, and you meet us in our home and our hunger with bread from heaven. Accompany us in this meal that we may pass over from death to life with Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
We know in the night which our Lord Jesus Christ is betrayed, he took bread. When he gave thanks, he broke it. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body. It's given for you. Do this to the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you, shed for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray together.
Our Father,
table you gather your people into one body for the sake of the world. did it or whether we don't. I'm trusting that God is working to bring about good as we go and pray that the Lord will bless us and keep us. That the Lord will make his face to shine upon us and be gracious unto us. May God give us grace now to sell ourselves short. Grace to risk something big for something good. Grace to realize the world is much too small for anything but love. And much too dangerous for anything but truth. And now may God take our minds and think through them. May God take our lips and speak through them. And may God take our hearts and set them on fire. In the name of Jesus Christ, who goes with us always. Amen.
To God.